and welcome. My name is Dan Wagner. I'm a professor in the School of Education here at Penn, and also the UNESCO Chair of Learning and Literacy. And I want to welcome you, as we say in UNESCO talk, ladies and gentlemen and distinguished guests, to this, and Penn community, to this special evening we have. And I think it couldn't be more appropriate that we have a snowy night that means that you all had to struggle hard to get here, and we know you are enthusiastic and passionate for the kinds of issues that we will be talking about tonight. Let me start by thanking the co-organizers on campus. There are a number of different organizers. Of course, the principal organizer is the Fels Institute of Government here at Penn. Perry World House, the new international house on campus. Fox Leadership International. The Christopher Brown Center for International Politics. And last but not least, the International Educational Development Program at Penn. Now why did I know that was going to be loud? So tonight we have a very special two guests, distinguished women and professionals in their own rights. And I'm going to begin with an introduction of our first conversationalist. Tonight is a conversation, as you probably noticed, something we don't do that often. Usually we give speeches and ask questions, but tonight we're going to have a conversation. And our first conversationalist is Marjorie Margolies Mazvinsky. And of course, most importantly, she is a graduate of Penn. But in addition, she was CBS News Foundation Fellow at Columbia University, the other university somewhere north of here. And she began as a television journalist here in Philadelphia. She was a journalist with NBC and a contributing correspondent for the Today Show and a number of other different shows where she won and was part of numerous awards in television. In 1992, Marjorie was the first woman elected to Congress from Pennsylvania, the state of Pennsylvania. And in 1995, she led the U.S. delegation to the UN Fourth World Conference on Women in Beijing. And inspired by those commitments, she founded Women's Campaign International that seeks to empower women around the world, in particular in developing countries. And so through the work of that organization, she's been helping women by giving or training tangible skills, political leadership, conflict mitigation, economic empowerment, and civic engagement. Here at Penn, Marjorie is a senior fellow on the faculty of the Fels Institute of Government. Our second guest, very special invited guest, who we usually have to beg and work years in advance to get on our schedule. We're delighted to have Irina Bokova with us tonight. She is Director General of UNESCO, or the long term is United Nations Educational, Scientific, and Cultural Organization. Most of you are aware of that organization. And you may be aware that Irina Bokova is originally from Bulgaria, and she has been the Director General since 2009, and she is the first woman ever elected head of UNESCO. Irina Bokova joined the Ministry of Foreign Affairs of Bulgaria in 1977. Where she was responsible for human rights and equality of women's issues. She was later appointed to the permanent mission of Bulgaria to the United Nations in New York and participated in the drafting of Bulgaria's new constitution, which contributed to the country's accession to the European Union. She was then appointed Minister of Foreign Affairs of Bulgaria, later Ambassador of Bulgaria to France, Monaco, and UNESCO in the years 2005 to 2009. I guess there was a lot of bags to pack during that era. And then she became Director General of UNESCO. Now she has lots of experience with universities. She was trained in Moscow State Institute of International Relations. She was telling me earlier that she did postgraduate study at another university a little south of here, University of Maryland, and yet another university, Harvard University, the John F. Kennedy School in Cambridge, Mass. Irina Bokova speaks five languages, Bulgarian, English, French, Spanish, and Russian, and we are hoping you will stay mainly in English tonight. So, of course, when you are the welcomer in chief, I guess I am tonight, I had an opportunity to see what she has recently been writing about and speaking about, and her schedule is intense. She gives talks all over the place and almost constantly, and to make a selection was difficult, but I found three quotes that I thought might set the stage for our thinking about what she has been trying to do with UNESCO and in the world in the last years since she's been Director General. The first is an area that I care about, literacy, and these are just three quotes. So the first one is, literacy is much more than an educational priority. It is the ultimate investment in the future. And the first step towards all the forms of literacy required in the 21st century. The second quote, people are more connected than ever before, but inequalities and misunderstandings remain deep within and among societies. Human capacity is the ultimate renewable energy, but it faces obstacles everywhere. And finally, gender equality benefits everyone, not just women. It is an accelerator of political, economic, and social transformations in today's world. So it's hard to summarize that, but if you've been listening to the political discourse here in the United States in the last month, even today, many of these issues resonate with you. And it's wonderful that we have a Director General of UNESCO that imbues this and is part of her speeches everywhere she goes. But since I have, I'm going to end on a personal note, because I have had the opportunity to meet the Director General on numerous occasions, and she's a very special person. I usually meet her when she is surrounded with crowds like this or even larger, usually diplomats from 100 different countries and professionals from many different disciplines. So it's obvious, or will be obvious to you, that she never fails to be both impressive and passionate. And I remember one occasion in particular, and it actually happens to be right here at the University of Pennsylvania. In March of 2012, almost 4 years ago, she came to Penn to establish a UNESCO chair in the Graduate School of Education. And we had made many arrangements, much as we have tonight, of food and organization and who's going to give talks and meetings with various officials and so on. And she met with the senior leadership and agreements were signed. But what struck me most was her meeting with the Penn students. In fact, she insisted, even though she had a very busy schedule, that she'd have a private seminar with the students in the School of Education, which she did do, and some of you will have seen her photograph on the website of the Graduate School of Education. So it's clear to me that she is a leader that is grounded in the future. She is interested in you, mainly students here today, because you are the future. She believes in bringing people and ideas together, and that is such a wonderful thing and such a personal thing for such a senior official in the United Nations system. So with that, we're going to start our special conversation, but I'd like us to welcome, and if I may, Marjorie and Irina to this very special event. So we will start this conversation. I just want to make a quick announcement that at the end, there will be time for questions and answers. There will be microphones that will be passed around. I pass it to you.
Let me just say she's really cool. She's so cool. I've been in a lot of situations with her, and we'll tell you about some of the more fun ones, don't you think? But why don't you tell them what the heck you do?
First, Marjorie, allow me to thank Dan and all of you for being here tonight, and particularly...
Oh, no, there's some people who really did a heck of a lot. Keys?
I think, yes, they
were. Warren? There are a lot of people who worked so hard on putting this together. Thank you.
And let me say that there could not have been a better beginning of this evening than meeting with all you, the students, that have been doing internships at UNESCO or that you are going to our offices all over the world. It was an amazing group of young students. Thank you so much.
And where were you where you ran into?
I went last year, year and a half ago, to Samoa, to the Pacific, where we had the United Nations Conference on Small Island Development States. And I found there somebody from UPenn saying, oh, I'm working here in the office of UNESCO, and I'm from the UPenn University. I don't know whether we have it here this evening. Maybe not. Not tonight. But I know that somebody else is leaving to Samoa, to the Pacific. Somebody is leaving you. Somebody is going to Nairobi. To Nairobi, to Bangkok, to South America, I think, to Paris, and it's just wonderful. So thank you so much for being interested in helping us in this world that is full of opportunities but a lot of trouble. So I'm happy that what we started with Dan just 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago, already we have 70 students that have been with us. And hopefully we have many more. But let me just say that it's real pleasure to see so many young people interested in the United Nations, interested in development, interested in climate, interested in the gender equality, interested in conflict, in what is happening nowadays in the Middle East and some other places, the humanitarian disaster that we're seeing all over the world. I think we need to talk about issues. We need to search for answers to some of these very, very difficult conflicts and problems and challenges that we confront. And I want to thank Marjorie because the Fels Institute of Government is one of those academic institutions that you're looking for answers.
I can continue just to ask you questions. Does that work, or do you want to address
whatever? We are talking, right?
We're just so hangers.
It's a talk.
No, but when you, how many of you really know what UNESCO does? Not you guys. I don't. But I mean, no. But I mean, how many of you know? Because I thought I did when we first started this. We just Women's Campaign International just. I'm going to start here because it was so much fun. Women's Campaign International just did a training with, is it Irina?
Irina, right.
Okay. Yeah. with Irina. And we do trainings with women. We want to get more women to the table, yes. And we went to Bulgaria because UNESCO and a woman, another group from Albania and we all sponsored us and got there. And it was so energizing. It was so lovely. And I'm just going to tell you a tiny little story, mainly because in the car we were talking about this. You know that women, men too, but women always say they're sorry. Always. In my class, they say they're sorry for saying they're sorry. But they say they're sorry a lot. And so we discussed this.
Yes.
And but we went on with the day, and somebody left. She didn't come in the afternoon, and at night, will you tell the rest of the story?
No, it was, there is a Council of Women in Business in Bulgaria, and there's this regional program for Southeastern Europe, and we did this training, leadership training, and Marjorie was saying, just don't apologize all the time. Don't say you're sorry.
Because you marginalize your next sentence. I mean, you say, I'm sorry, maybe it isn't the right time to say this. You know, it just, your next sentence is marginalized. Okay,
so one of the CEOs of a big company, private company, was missing, and then she came and she said, she entered the room and she said, I'm not apologizing anymore, I'm not saying I'm sorry. She wanted to say it, but then she said, I'm not apologizing.
She was walking in to sell something, and
yes.
And
then she stopped.
She said, wait a minute, I'm not going to say I'm sorry. And she walked in and she said, this is a great idea, and she sold it. And she came back that night, and she was so excited. I mean, now, it's such a simple idea, and it's so great. But we've got to, that's what, we talk about conflict mitigation, and that's what I'd really like to get into, yes. Because one of the things that UNESCO does, and it does well, and some of it's very frightening, is you deal with, especially the historic sites, you deal with a lot of problems that come to the fore with terrorism.
I would like to start because you said what UNESCO is doing, and mentioning also the destruction of heritage. Let me just go back a little bit, because we just celebrated our 70th anniversary. UNESCO was one of the first United Nations agency established after the Second World War. In fact, the United Nations themselves celebrated 70th anniversary. And UNESCO was the idea about creating an organization based on the intellectual solidarity of humanity was born even before the end of the Second World War. There was a conference of ministers of education in 1942 convened in London by the then Minister of Education of the United Kingdom. And the idea was that only in a military manner, only with weapons, you cannot impose peace. You need to have this moral, intellectual solidarity of humanity to have the soft power of the United Nations in order to have peace and to attain development and respect for human rights. So this is how UNESCO was born, to promote international cooperation in education, in culture, in sciences, and then later came also the idea about communication and information. And all these 7 years, UNESCO has launched an incredibly important, in my view, intellectual ideas. I say intellectual ideas because then they were transformed into reality. The very idea of the importance of education, because we were speaking about education, did not exist at that time. This global movement about literacy, about education for all, the importance of education, was brought much later to the forefront of the international community. The idea about biodiversity, how important it is to maintain the biodiversity, to have sustainable development, renewable energies, all these ideas were born at UNESCO, and then they were kind of thrown to the world, and they were taken on board by other agencies, entities, academic institutions, and others. And this is where the great idea about common heritage of humanity came with the adoption of the, in 1972, of the convention, UNESCO Convention on the Protection of World Heritage. And now we are used to it. Here in Philadelphia, we have the Independence Hall, which is on the World Heritage List. We have the Statue of Liberty. We have the Great Chinese Wall. We have the Borobudur, we have Angkor Wat. All these great monuments are considered to be outstanding universal value. And I think this great idea, for the time, at those times it was a revolutionary idea, that we, all humanity, we are uniting around the respect, the protection of a culture which does not belong to us. And I think this is the greatest of these ideas, that we protect culture that is culture of the others, we respect it, and then through this we have this so much needed intercultural dialogue. We live together respecting the others.
Has the office always been in Paris?
Yes. UNESCO has been, the first conference was in London, in our constitution in London, but we are still, then they moved to Paris. So now we see a terrible destruction of heritage, what you, Marjorie, asked me, because we see the rise of extremism, not just extremism, it's a violent extremism. We see what is happening with the so-called Islamic State, Caliphate, in Syria, in Iraq. We see what happens in the Sahel. We saw the destruction of monuments in Mali. We see abduction of and killing of children and people, persecution in Nigeria almost every day. We see the same in Somalia, in Kenya, I believe that what is coming nowadays is one of the worst I would say, threats that we have for peace, for security, for development, for some values that we all share within the United Nations and at UNESCO. So what I call cultural cleansing is destruction of heritage. We saw what happened with Palmyra and some of the other sites, which bear, I would say, the values of millennium of culture, of intercultural dialogue. Where some of them belong to the Assyrian culture, the birth of human civilization in the Middle East. They persecute minorities, they destroy temples, mosques, churches, synagogues. Some of the statues that belong to these very ancient civilizations, they persecute minorities, they chase them, they enslave women and children, they are selling them as slaves. And what is, I would say, the most terrible consequence of all this, using new technologies, because they are very savvy in using new technologies, it is youth radicalization in many parts of the world. We saw only in France terrible attacks last year, the last one being in November, where more than 100 people were killed indiscriminately. They attacked journalists, they killed before that journalists. We saw attacks in Tunisia, in Cairo, in Beirut, in Indonesia. So I think something is happening that needs much more focus and collective response from all of us. Now, from the point of view of UNESCO, we think that the response to this call for to fight for the young minds and hearts is something very important, very high on our agenda. On one side, we think that through education, we have to give responses, and we convened with the United States a mission at UNESCO, the first ever meeting of Conference of Ministers of Education, where we had the Undersecretary of State, Antony Blinken, opening this conference, talking about how through education we should prevent. I think the prevention is very much important. How we should prevent violent extremism and youth radicalization. If I go a little bit early on in September, President Obama convened at the United Nations the first summit on combating violent extremism, and I was very honored to be the only head of agency invited to speak on the prevention, what we should do in order to prevent this through education, through culture, through intercultural dialogue, through protection of heritage. Because I do believe that it is a plague nowadays that is like a cancer. It's going around societies, and we have to do more in order to prevent it.
You also, in addition to the early education, you have programs for journalists.
Yes. UNESCO is the agency also that has the responsibility for the freedom of expression. And I would say, recently, once again, because of what we see in the world for the safety of journalists. In fact, we launched 2 years ago a United Nations plan for the safety of journalists. It is approved by the United Nations, all the agencies. We established even an international day. The 2nd of November is an international day for the safety of journalists. And the first time we celebrated it, 2 years ago, I decided it was the day when I went to Baghdad, to Iraq. I visited the museum of Baghdad in order to once again show solidarity with the Iraqi government, with the Iraqi people. It was just the advent of the extremists that were occupying some territories of Iraq, and we celebrated also the International Day for the safety of journalists. Let me just say that just last week, on Friday, we had a major conference at UNESCO headquarters where we had a famous journalist, Christiana Mampur, whom I appointed recently as UNESCO Special Envoy for the Safety of Journalists, with her and another prominent BBC journalist, Zeina Badawi, a good friend also. Both of them were moderating our discussions. We invited the mother of James Foley, the very famous American journalist who was so cruelly beheaded, and his mother was, she started the foundation, the Foley Foundation for the Safety of Journalists, so that she could continue what he was doing, informing in the most difficult of the circumstances, informing about conflict and how important it is to resist this. But let me just say, talking about the safety of journalists, only last year we saw 105 journalists being killed. The previous year, 2014, there were 87. And altogether, in the last 10 years, we see more than 600 journalists that have been killed. Now the shift goes to journalists killed in conflict, but we know that very many of them also are killed in their local journalists, their journalists that are uncovering a crime, a corruption, and this is also something that we have to be concerned. We work strongly against the impunity. I think it's so important that we do not allow impunity to be part of what is happening. We work with judges, we work with lawyers, with judicial systems, with police officers, with the journalist associations in order to bring an end to this impunity.
We'll come back to all of this, and I know that some of you are going to want to ask questions, but I would like to talk a little bit about what you're trying to do. Actually, what we're trying to. It is very, there's a push now to hopefully make sure that the person who replaces Ban Ki-moon is a woman. actually, before I met you, I had heard she's one of the names that keeps on coming up for a couple of reasons. First of all, she's fabulous, but she's from the right part of the world. They are interested, we are told, in looking at folks from the EU, from your, especially from your hood. I'm going to weave something in which was just strange. Do any of you read the Wall Street Journal? No. That's good news. Today there was an article which I kind of want to talk to you about, but I also want to talk to you about what the positive today her government decided to throw their support to you.
Yes, they informed the president of the General Assembly and the chair president of the Security Council. That's true.
That deserves applause.
Marjorie, you're saying this is not a coincidence that I'm here this evening, right?
Correct.
Yeah?
Correct. And you all have to write into somebody. No, but we've been following her path towards it. And I think what we saw today was how, first of all, this was such a great day that your country came and said, because there had been a little bit of infighting, that's over.
Politics.
Yeah.
You know this. Democracy.
It's looking good, so follow it. It's really exciting. And then when she gets there, all of you can come visit. You would love that, wouldn't you? And most of you can have jobs. But today, it was interesting to me because I woke up and I got a call from Washington, read the Wall Street Journal, and it was a misrepresentation. And it's something that we have to put up with all the time. And I just want you to address it a tiny bit, and then we'll get back to how proud of you we are.
Well, I mean, journalists are journalists. Freedom of
expression.
Of expression.
Yes. And they love things that are a bit negative.
Well, yeah, sometimes I think what is a bit frustrating, but I think I'm sure that they will find the truth, is when things are not presenting, or the facts are not there. But there is always a possibility to correct some of the things. So I think in this particular article, what for me was, and I felt a little bit hurt, was saying that, some of what UNESCO is doing, or I personally, is not exactly within the interests of the United States, and I do not agree with this, and I have said it many times.
I mean, you studied here, your kids are here. I mean, it's not like, yes.
Yeah, not only. I think UNESCO, I remember there was an article when I was elected, and then when I started working, there was an article in New York Times, which I liked very much, a phrase, because the U.S. Left UNESCO in the 80s, and it was a deliberate decision to leave it. It was felt that this organization does not share some of the core values of the United States. And then in 2003, UNESCO came back.
United States came back to UNESCO. Correct.
Because it was felt that this is an important organization. It was in the aftermath of 9/11. And at that time, President Bush and the administration decided, and rightfully so, that UNESCO is this big platform to reach out to the other cultures, to the world, and since then, the United States is involved. And then there was this article after I was elected by the then correspondent in Paris, who was saying, UNESCO today is not your grandmother's UNESCO. And I think this is very important, because I do believe that what we do nowadays very much goes along the core, I would say, American values. We talk about the freedom of expression, we talk about media, we talk about safety of journalists. It is, I believe, in the interest of the US and the Americans. We talk about combating violent extremism, and what we do, either through education, in order to stop the illicit trafficking of objects of art, of these blood antiquities, with the money.
And of human beings.
And of human beings, because with this, the humanitarian disaster is continued. We talk even here about education, about literacy. We speak about gender equality. We speak about girls'
education.
And
one of the things that we have been working on is making sure that we get more women to the table. It makes a difference. And that's one of the things that we hope to be doing together over the next several months. But I want you to explain to them how you are campaigning for this. And that may not be the right word, but you understand that you told me that when you first were approached to be a part of UNESCO, you kind of said, come on, I'm not a politician. I don't want to be campaigning for this. And you found that, A, you had to do it, that you were successful, you're very good at it. And now you find yourself in a position to put all of these pieces together, which may work, and we certainly, you know, are hoping that it does. But what are you doing now to make sure that...
I would say something in secret, but please don't say it outside this hall.
This is off the record.
I don't have time to campaign. I'm not campaigning, but okay. Tell everybody the time. I think...
you're just doing your job well, yeah, and it's the kind of thing that
I have always said that if UNESCO is doing well, I think, and I really believe that UNESCO is so important nowadays. We are having such an incredibly important agenda. Just an example, the United Nations adopted the Agenda for Sustainable Development 2030. Out of 17 goals, we have a very direct relevance to 9. We are so much engaged in education. We are leading the goal number 4 on education. We are involved into the heritage, urban developments and protection of heritage. We are involved in the gender equality, of course. We are involved in water management. We are involved in oceans, goal number 14. So you name it. Whenever you see, we have some very direct responsibility to do. And particularly now after the climate conference in Paris, with the achievement, we were very much working with the French. We had joint teams to work for the success of this conference. Now we have to translate all this into practice. So, as you see, I have a huge agenda.
Right. Well, but that's interesting.
But tell everybody that I'm campaigning hard, because otherwise they will think I'm not serious.
No, but it's nice that it dovetails into exactly what you're doing. So you can meet with people and make sure that they know what you're doing, because it is so much a part of what the United Nations should...
Oh, absolutely. I was just recently, last week, I was in London during the pledging conference on Syria. And I did participate in a number of meetings, mainly on education, because we work in refugee camps. We support some of the displaced, big displaced populations in Jordan, in Lebanon, in Iraq. We were campaigning, we were advocating for more funds to go to education, but not just education, but I would say also young people's skills in order to prevent this radicalization. So I think there are really important issues on the table nowadays where we have to act immediately.
I just have one quick question, and then we're going to open it up to audience questions. So if you're thinking about asking a question, please get yourself to a microphone, which is over there. Okay, that's good. One of the things that I think we really take, we especially here, take for granted is water. And it's one of the areas that UNESCO is very interested in. If you could just very quickly tell us a little bit about how incredibly important that is. Water.
Water. Water is incredibly important, you're right, because we see with the climate change, with the unreasonable use of water resources, we see conflict, we see poverty, we see prevention of kids going to school just
illness.
Because they have to illness, yeah. Health. And we always say that water is much more than a technical issue. Water is about life, water is about gender equality, water is about poverty alleviation, water diplomacy also is about preventing conflict. And that is why we are hosting the only United Nations intergovernmental program, which is the big hydrological program hosted by UNESCO. We work on water security. We have institutes. We have the biggest school of postgraduate studies in water management in the Netherlands. We produce, of course, with the cooperation with the other United Nations agencies, but the World Water Reports are in fact produced by us, by UNESCO. We have a World Water Assessment Program, which is in Italy, in Perugia, and I will be going there just next week on the 17th, no, on the 15th. I'm in Perugia. We have a big conference on water management. We were leading the international, we had the United Nations International Year on Water Cooperation, because we see all too often conflicts around water resources. We see that in Africa, around the Nile River. We said we see this also in Central Asia. We see it in East Asia also. So water is something very important, very high on our agenda.
And Women's Campaign International is very, very aware of this. We know that if we go into a village and just drill a well, we save the village thousands and thousands of hours.
You know, Marjorie, I went for the first time in Chad some 3 or 4 years ago. I went there in order to advocate for girls' education, and we have a lot of programs. I visited also Lake Chad, which now we know that 30% of the water resources already have been depleted, and 30 million people's livelihoods are there at stake. And part of the extremism that is around in this area, Boko Haram and others, is also because of this poverty and lack of the good management of these water resources. And I went to see the president, and I advocated for girls' education. This is a country where they have to make a incredible effort in order to get girls in schools. And I said, you know, we want you to allocate resources, we want to help in order to make this. And he stopped me and he said, I'm convinced, but you know what? How we will solve the problem with girls going to schools? solve the problem with water.
No.
And this is where, because girls are going to fetch water if there is a well only in between
hours
three villages.
Hours.
And that is
yes.
How interlinked are all these yes. issues.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Questions?
Yeah, so we, thank you very much. We do have two traveling mic fellows. Aaron and Tyler, you have mics. And I'll give you mine in just a second, Aaron. And then if you raise your hands, the mic will come toward you for a brief question.
Over there?
But before, I want to ask my own question, if I may.
Okay.
Welcome risk privilege. Madam Director General, one of the universities that has been working with UNESCO. You made very positive comments, thank you very much, about students who have gone and interned and so on. What can we do more as a wealthy, famous even, university that is interested in doing good in the world? What could we do more for people to think about, students in particular? I get this question a lot, actually, from both students and faculty. I wonder if you could speak to that just for a moment, and we'll pass around the microphones.
I think we need a lot more of academic research on all these so important issues of sustainable development. We lack data. We know that we all are talking about the data revolution nowadays, because without data, you cannot have the right policies. We need more international studies about international development. I think one of the most important needs nowadays is to have international development studies. People know what are speaking about water, speaking about literacy, about education, about energy, about gender, girls' education, women. I think there's a vast area of a need for international development studies. And universities like yours is so well placed to do this, to prepare people, specialists who could go and who could help these countries get the right policies and do the right things. On the other side, I think that having a more open and cooperation with universities from other countries, from the developing countries, is something that also is extremely important. UNESCO chairs or centers, or just bring on board universities that need support in order to achieve some higher excellence in their studies, in their teachings, is very much in demand. Because nowadays, without higher education, we don't think that some of these issues. Too long, the international community was focusing only on primary education. And we have seen that this is not an answer anymore. And goal number four, that was approved by the United Nations, and you then participated in all the efforts that we have made, is setting a very high goal, very high standard, to achieve primary and secondary education and move. So all these countries need support in order to have this quality and excellence in education.
Thank you, and I'm so glad you said that. You guys all listened to that, right? Thank you for that. I see some hands up, so why don't...
one over there.
One back there, another here, another there. Microphones. Go ahead.
Can you stand up and say your name?
Hi, my name is Ariel. I'm an archaeology major, and I have a lot of friends who don't understand why I'm passionate about preserving culture of the past and heritage. And I was wondering what you'd say to those people who are, you know, don't understand what's the point of preserving cultural heritage and past, you know.
Are you supposed to get it?
Please.
Well, I think without culture, we are not human beings. Without knowing the history, without knowing where we come from, without knowing the evolving understanding about culture and beauty, and also about knowing this incredible cultural diversity in the world, we will not have identity. Culture is about identity. Culture and heritage is about who we are. And I'm sure that each one of you coming from different countries or parts, you always think about something that is very close to your heart as identity. And I think this is very important because nowadays the world, we have an incredible diversity in the world. Without knowing the culture, without having the cultural competencies, literacies, I think we will not have the right way of living together. And one of the biggest challenges today in the world is living together. And without knowing this, we will not achieve this.
Thank you, Director General. My name is Galton, and I'm a junior here. I was wondering, what inspires you? What drives you to make this world a better place? What makes you work so hard day in and day out to change everything?
You know, I, by the way, when I was young in school, I wanted to become an archaeologist. And I thought I'm discovering new civilizations, new worlds. I worked as a student at some archaeological excavations, and then I decided that this is the way to understand the world. I think probably because I traveled a lot, and very early on I was interested in countries, in studying foreign languages, and I saw what a beautiful place this world is, what an incredible place to have this diversity. I'm always fascinated by meeting different people, different cultures, different societies, communities. And I think we will make probably the biggest crime if we don't preserve this this diversity and this planet and this earth. I think this is probably the most important thing that we have to do. I have five grandchildren. I want to leave them this planet and this humanity. I think this is wonderful.
We have one over here.
Go ahead.
Thank you, Mr. Wagner, and thank you, Ms. Marjolies. Mrs. Bokova, I'm a first-year master student from Education Policy Program. I actually, in one of my public policy classes, we talked about leadership with and without authority a lot. So my question is about leadership. Can you share with us some examples when you use the power of the leadership? Especially maybe from the perspective of a woman or maybe from the UNESCO's perspective. Thank you.
How about the women one?
Leadership, I think, is comes when you believe in something. You have to believe in something. You have to have some convictions, what is right, what is not right. I wouldn't say wrong, I say what is not right, according to you. And then I think in difficult circumstances to take decisions, to take risks, decisions that may be not very popular, or that may not be immediately an immediate success, but to do it with the conviction that you do the right thing. And when you do this, then you look around and you see that people follow. I think Marjorie knows this also, but in my professional career there have been instances, cases where it was very risky, and I was not sleeping, I was hesitating, but I was telling myself, if I don't do it, I should not be here in this position. So I think this is it. And if you do it, you look around. For women, maybe it's a bit more difficult, because women are not always, I say, sometimes yes, but not always believed to be taking such risks and to do such things. Always they say, oh, is she strong or not strong, you know, with women. I don't know your experience, but I'm participating in many such similar debates, and the two questions always are asked when a woman is to be given an important responsibility or something. There, is she strong and is she competent? And once I said, could you define what strength is, what strong is? I'm giving this example because I was to appoint, I appointed at UNESCO half of my team, my deputies are women and half are men for the first time. When I came, there was only one woman among 10 assistants. Now they're half-half. And we're approaching almost half of the director and upper level. We are the highest in the United Nations system. I'm very proud of this because I think women have to support other women. And I think that women should not think that they're there just because they're competent and others are not. I really believe that we have to support. And I was to appoint, I was recruiting a director for our hydrological program, international hydrological program, and very competitive, very strong candidates, and few women among them, but one was really very, very good. At the end of the day, I appointed her. She's Mexican. But the panel, when they were discussing, because we have panels, and of course, men were also good, very good, strong candidates. And when it came to her, they said, well, you know, we're not very sure. No, we need somebody strong here as a director. I said, yes, I also want a strong director. It's an important program. Then once again around, and they said, but you know, we need strong. I said, could you define strong? They're going to carry water or to dig wells. Define what strong means for this post. So they were very confused. And they recommended two, three men and her, and finally I appointed her, and she's a very good director. But I think in the leadership, for women, it's definitely more more difficult because leadership is not to scream, to shout, and to you know, make big noise. It is about making the right decisions and to lead by example. I think this is very important.
And also, when I can remember when I first went to Congress, something I had to leave behind was that we are brought up to please people. And sometimes you have to say, I'm not so sure that I want to keep everybody happy. There is a line which you have to kind of, you have to create an office that works, and you don't have to necessarily keep everybody happy. It is the reason you sometimes hire other people to be a little tough in the office. But I think you have to read your own personality and say what works. And sometimes that's very challenging.
I think we have somebody back there.
Hi, my name is Karun Mehta. I'm a graduate student here. We talked about a lot of cultural tolerance today and women's empowerment. All those are great issues, but I don't think we touched on the topic of racial intolerance and the growing racial intolerance in the U.S. today and even in the world, especially when you see we have these big headlines about attacks in Paris and 200 people dead, but when 20,000 people are killed by the Boko Haram in the last few years and there is 2.3 million people displaced, we have like pretty much no talk about that even in the last 6 months. What are your thoughts? What should the UNESCO be doing? What should the people in the world be doing as a whole to try and bridge this gap?
No, I totally agree with you. I just mentioned the Paris attacks because it is very unusual for such a country that has enjoyed peace. But definitely I started mentioning also not only Boko Haram, but all these horrendous acts that are coming. We don't know still where are the 200 girls abducted, if you remember the Chibok school, and but after that there are almost every week or every month we hear about such horrible stories. We see not only there, we see also in the neighboring countries, in the Sahel, humanitarian disaster, I would say. But to come back to what you started with the racial intolerance and discrimination, I agree with you that unfortunately we see this on the rise, and it's kind of a paradoxical in this world because we We think that we are more connected. We think that we are having more information, knowledge about the others, but at the same time, we are as if more fragmented, and we are seeing sometimes communities that go back, take a shield, a refuge into their own, and they don't accept the others. So I think what is very much needed, and this is in what UNESCO is doing, UNESCO has been this organization that has launched incredibly important programs and has done a lot in order to understand the others. UNESCO has made the histories of different cultures of the world. UNESCO has published last year only, we published the very important research on foundations of Islam. We have the Slave Route Project, where we see the influences and what happened also with the slavery. We have created and drafted for the first time ever General History of Africa. Our last volume of the General History of Africa is about the African diaspora that we launched in the Caribbean. We translated this in Portuguese, and now it is in the Brazilian schools, because more than 50%, I think recently they told me that maybe 60% of Brazilians have African blood in them, they come from there. And also we are translating this into textbooks for the African children, because until recently, African children in different countries were studying history of their colonizers and not of their own history. So I think all this is, but we do that not only for the African countries, we want this history to be taught also in European schools, in American schools, and in others, so that we really know about each other, and we respect and we value each other. I think this is incredibly important. On the other side, we are also teaching, we are the organization that is, and I developed this in the last 5 years, the teaching of Holocaust education, but linking it to preventing of genocides, of drawing lessons of history, and teaching respect for all. So I think all these important, I would say, initiatives, launching of different programs, should have a big impact on mutual respect of people. I think it is very important. But as I agree with you, what is happening in the world, the internal conflicts and this polarization and radicalization, unfortunately, is bringing a lot more of intolerance, acceptance of the others, and this is something that we have to think. Yes. Xenophobia is terrible.
Yeah, so there are a lot of hands. We'll just take two or three more questions. I see a gentleman here who's had his hand up for a while, right in the middle.
Good evening, Director General. I'm Alejandro. I'm a PhD candidate in psychology. And my question is, in the domain of education, and particularly focused in the bottom of the pyramid worldwide, both within developing and developed countries, and beyond traditional academic knowledge, like math, science, reading, things like that PISA and other exams capture, what do you think are the three most important skills that the youth around the world should learn to deal with the challenges and take advantage of the opportunities in the next couple of decades?
Well, I think, and I have here more experts on education, but we are increasingly speak about quality education, and recently we developed also with the World Bank, UNICEF, Brookings, what defines actually quality of education. And then we developed a little bit larger, expanded this vision, because as you say, it's not just math or reading or writing. Of course, computer skills and digital knowledge is important, but it is much more than that. It is about values. It is about education for human rights. It is about education for protecting the environment, what we call education for sustainable development. And when we put all this together, and by the way, we had end of 2014 in Nagoya, in Japan, in November, a big conference that wrapped up an important decade of the United Nations of Education for Sustainable Development. It is also about education for living together. It is about these cultural competencies that we're speaking with you now. So taking all this together, we kind of named it Education for Global Citizenship, because it is very important that you young people or kids in school get out with some values, value system, which is very important. And this Education for Global Citizenship became one of the targets of the goal number 4 of the Sustainable Development Agenda. And now we are in the process of elaborating of the different elements of this Education for Sustainable Development. We have the first chair UNESCO, and coming from LA, in the UCLA, we have in the School of Education there Professor Carlo Torres, that Dan you know very well, who is our chair. I launched this UNESCO chair at a big celebration of the 70th anniversary yesterday evening for the Education for Sustainable Development. I think this is absolutely key if we want to achieve anything we want, if we want to protect the environment, to achieve gender equality, to tolerance, understanding about each other, you name it. It is just the what we have in our textbooks and what we teach in terms of values.
Okay, take one more question, Mr. Gentleman. Actually, I'm going to take two questions. One, two. Man, woman. If it equals. First one, this gentleman here, and second one, tomorrow.
Thank you very much.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much, Madam Bokova, and thank you so much to the University of Pennsylvania and the great work that it does in educating the public. I have two very quick questions for you.
One.
Why do you put the great work of the UNESCO in great danger by invoking the great organization in the war against terrorism? By doing so, you are somehow creating soft target of all those great workers that we have all over the world. Hmm.
I know this. I know there is a debate on this. I know this argument. And let me say that at the beginning, when this destruction started, there were people who were coming and saying, "Oh, just be calm, be quiet, just don't speak about that, because there will be." Targeting more and more. But I don't believe this is possible anymore. We have the social networks, we have all the information, we have the internet, we see it. We have YouTube, we have satellites, we see what is happening. And if you don't speak out, first, I don't think that they will stop. It is not what provokes them to do this. Let me just give an example with the illicit trafficking. They do sometimes this for money. We monitor by satellites, some of these World Heritage sites, and I can show you photos of before and after, and you can see the dozens, if not hundreds, of holes around Palmyra or some of these sites, because they dig, they take something in the land, because it's so rich of heritage, of archaeology. They take, they sell, they get money, and they continue once again their criminal activities. So I don't think that it is possible anymore to be silent. If I don't speak, you will speak. Other people will speak. We know what a huge outrage in the world all these atrocities provoke. So I don't think that this is an option anymore. And I don't think that if we keep quiet, they will stop this cultural cleansing.
Your point is very important, and I'm. The question is, do you make such a big deal out of it? I mean, the more you put it on television, you're feeding into the need that is very clear they have. But we can't be silent.
Listen, there is somebody's job. There is somebody's job in the United Nations to fight terrorism, to educate the people against terrorism. But when it comes to the UNESCO, the UNICEF, and the World Health Organization, usually in the world, when those three organizations, in addition to the United Nations logo, it used to be equivalent to the logo of the Red Cross, If you see it, even if you are a criminal, you can you don't attack it. But once the UNESCO start fight terrorism, the UNESCO will lose its neutrality in those endangered places.
But
we are not fighting them with arms.
Your job is more information.
We are not fighting them with arms. We are exactly in the prevention. We want to teach young people about values. We want to teach young people about the importance of heritage. We want to teach them why they have to resist to these extremist activities. Otherwise, why are we here?
Right.
This
and
is precisely about the United States. Be aware of it. About the, we're not taking the arms. We're not going there with Kalashnikovs to fight them. We're not into the... But we teach the peacekeepers. You know what we did in Mali, for example? In Mali, when the United Nations peacekeepers went, and before that the French troops and the Chadian troops and the other African troops, when they chased terrorists, we prepared a small passport. We printed 8,000 passports for heritage. We wanted every single soldier to have it in his pocket or her pocket in order to know how to protect, where are these valuables, valuable monuments, in order to protect them. We introduce into the peacekeepers now, in the United Nations, into their mandate to protect heritage. We are teaching them, but we are not going there ourselves. So now we have already in many of the mandates, the peacekeepers, also for the first time, the responsibility to protect culture and heritage. And I think this is also what we should do in order to fulfill our mandate. But we are not taking the arms ourselves.
Okay, we have one more question. Back here, introduce yourself.
Hi, Ms. Bokova. I'm a first year IEDP student, and I'm interested in promoting gender equality in developing countries through designing a national curriculum for pre-K to the sixth grade students. However, you know that on the women conference in Beijing, when we negotiating for the platform for action Beijing, a lot of terms relate to sex rights of women were in brackets and were at the center of heated argument. So the situation still existing in many developing countries and cultures today, like local communities gonna resist very strongly against implementation of sex education curriculum. So could you please share like international organizations like UNESCO, what can you do and what will you do to address this kind of issues and help to promoting the female access to this relevant knowledge, like early pregnancy, STDs, and also the safe abortion? Thank you.
I think this is very important issue, and UNESCO sometimes is criticized that we are promoting sexuality education. But we do that precisely because either to fight AIDS, because we are one of those organizations within the, we have 11 organizations of the United Nations that are, we call the convening agencies around UNAIDS, and we're working in the preventive, in the education area. By the way, it's very important, we have a very specific project in countries for fighting early pregnancies and knowledge about it. Albeit, as I say, sometimes we are criticized, but we think this is very important for the health. And we are one of those also agencies which sometimes we take unpopular in different communities or I would say circumstances initiatives. We are the agency that started working on bullying in schools, and I think this is very important, homophobic bullying in schools. We have started very very interesting projects in Latin America. We started in Brazil, we moved to other countries, and we hope to go also to some of the other societies, and we're working with some of our member states maybe next year to have a bigger conference on this type of, I would say, human rights, because this is a human right, and particularly in terms of education, how we prevent bullying in schools in order to have a safe education environment.
Thank you so much. Help put this together, and thank you. Isn't she terrific? And watch her, because there's no stopping her. And if you have any, this is very important. Before you go, eat. You don't have anything as interesting at home. Make sure you eat and have a good one.
Thank you very much.